My name is Jocelyn Cesari. I'm a senior research fellow here at the Berkley Center, and I am also a professor of religion and politics at the University of Birmingham in the UK. I'm very happy to convene this panel about religion and foreign policy, the occasion being a report released in last April by the German Marshall Fund, which is also running a transatlantic academy that had as a topic religion and foreign policy. And the final product can be grabbed in the back of the room, either on your way in or out. So feel free to take a copy. And the title is Faith, Freedom and Foreign Policy, Challenges for the Transatlantic Community. So this report is really coming at the right time where the concern of religion has become more and more acute, first in the academic domain itself. I am a political scientist, and I can tell you that when I arrived in this country in 1998, there were very little interest on religion and foreign policy, and 9/11 happened and everything changed. And on the side of foreign policy or international action, religion was pretty much unknown, and things have changed since that, but I would not say for the better, and maybe I will explain this a little more in my overall presentation. So it comes at the right time, mixing lots of very strong academic point with policy making concerns, and also emphasizing something that is there and not always present in the discourse, especially on this side of the Atlantic, more on the other side, which is the difference between Europe and the US when it comes to foreign policy and religion. So having said that, I would like, for the sake of the discussion, to introduce all the participants. Then I will give my own remarks for 10 minutes. And then each of the person here will present. Some, and they will explain themselves, are co-author of the report. Some are not, and we are also expecting someone from the US State Department to say a few words on the current work on US foreign policy and religion. So let me get started here with a quotation from Stalin. Yes, I know. In 1935, Stalin asked how many divisions to gauge the relevance of the Vatican on the international scene. And by saying that, he pretty much encapsulated the disdain of state rulers at the time vis-a-vis religion as a significant part of world politics. It was neither good nor bad. Religion didn't matter. There were several reasons for this neglect. And I would say that the scholarship in the last 15 years has really addressed the reasons for this neglect of religion in international relations. The fact that the international community was built on a club of rational state actors, acting primarily on material and security interests. And this is pretty much the dominant narrative that you can find even now in the mainstream political science. And the realistic school is not dead. I can tell you that really strongly. And it is not completely historically validated, actually. But it's part of the myth of what international relation and international system should be. As you know, with the end of the Cold War, you see the emergence of an interest for, at the time it was framed as culture, at the end of the Cold War, and more specifically with the turning point of 9/11. Although the work of Samuel Huntington predates 9/11, the end of the Cold War is really, for the international relations scholar, the moment to address, and it's interesting, Samuel Huntington doesn't talk about religion, he talks about civilizations. And it will, and it still dominates, it's still, at least in the media or even in policy making, it still dominates the vision or the apprehension of what religion is at the international level. So I would say that the Huntington position is based on a premise that cannot be simply dismissed. What Samuel Huntington is saying at the time, that is pretty uncomfortable for most of the scholars in the discipline, is that identity and culture play a decisive role in international relations. The problem with his position is not that he's saying that. That's why sometimes I say he's half right, but he's also half wrong. Because when he looks at culture and civilization, what is he talking about? He is presenting what's called the common sense or the popular approach to what a civilization is or a culture is. When you start, you know, when you start listing the features of any ethnic, religious, cultural community, you are on a process that anthropologists and sociologists call reification. And that's the gap here. And I would say that this gap is still not bridged between the interest in among politics or scholars of politics on religion and the fact that religion, culture, ethnicity, civilization have been discussed and analyzed by anthropologists and sociologists for at least three decades. But the work of the two is not connecting. So when political scientists are acting or looking into religion, they just work on what they think is religion, you know, or what they think is civilization, or what they think the West is. And interestingly, it is why it's appealing, because it is not asking a more, I would say, in-depth work of getting out of your comfort zone to really look into what the reality is and how we know it, not how we just think of it. And that's why I think it was good to introduce culture and religion on the international relation agenda. It was not the right way to just take on, you know, Buddhism is, I mean, we all have this cliche, you know, Buddhism is the religion of peace and love, right? I mean, and Islam is the religion of the sword. He has a chapter called The Bloody Frontiers of Islam that is exactly operating on this assumption that is not validated by facts, okay? I know I'm saying that in the middle of an ISIS crisis, but all the facts, the hard facts, show that the religion is never the exclusive variable to understand political violence. It doesn't matter, it works. And it does influence the way that policymakers now have to deal with religion. Because if the work of Samuel Huntington became known through his angle on Islam, I would say that pretty much what he's saying on Islam is affecting all our perception on religion and IR. Why? Because you look at the work that is done. There is an assumption that religion is triggering more political violence than any other ideology, which is also not historically validated, one. Two, that the conflicts triggered by religion are less negotiable or less prone to compromise than others, which is also not proven by the fact. That religion lead to more totalitarian or uncivil or undemocratic forms of regime, which is again not a permanent or continuous situation when it comes to religion. Think of the Catholic Church and the alliance of the Catholic Church with a fascist regime in Europe. You can listen to the discourse. At the time, there was no discourse on the Catholic, but you could look at the alliance between authoritarianism and Catholic Church at the time, like you can look today at the role of Islam on authoritarian regime here now. So it's also an evolution in time. It's also a change in context and in parameters. Some of my friends who do Catholic Islamism and sociology say that the discourse today on Islam could have been the discourse on Catholicism before what's called the second wave of democratization, with democratization of Spain, Italy, and then Latin America. So what is the alternative approach? And some of the contributors here will say a few words on that or present their contribution in this light. But what I can say is that this kind of work, as a report is showing, is very important to bridge this gap between academic and political interest on religion and the wealth of knowledge that we have now accumulated through anthropology and sociology on religion. One big obstacle that both scholars and policymakers are facing is to look at religion beyond belief. Again, I'm not saying that religion doesn't include belief. Of course it does. But if you look at the work that is triggered, is looking at what the theologians are saying, looking at what the position on ideology is, with the idea that if these people from Bin Laden to Baghdadi are saying this kind of thing, it has have a trigger, automatic trigger effect on the behavior of people. We know now from sociology of religion that it doesn't work this way. And that actually religion, to talk like one of my colleagues in Europe, is three B's, it's not only one. It's the belief, the behave, and the belong. And that actually, and I don't want to be too long here, but what is the most significant, especially when we want to look at action and processes, is the behaving and belonging, not too much the belief. And this comes from a bias that we have as Westerners, scholars, or policymakers, because in the West, the religion has been shaped and reshaped as primarily a personal faith or spirituality on which the individual has a choice. But we know now, again, that in 90, I would say even 95% of the world, religion is not personal belief. Religion is about commitment to a community. Religion is about behaving. And I did interviews among different believers, followers of different religions. It was fascinating to see that among the people who are not in the West, I interviewed them in different setting, immigrant setting in Europe and the US. None of them, the non-Western, all of them talk about doing things, not believing. The one we're talking about believing were the people who were, you know, rooted in the Western culture. And they were talking about believing and deeds and doctrine, while the people outside were saying, oh, I am a believer. It means I have to do things. I don't know what believing is, but I have to do things. Either covering, not covering, following dietary rules or not following. I'm not talking about Islam only here. I'm talking also about Judaism. I'm also talking about different form of Sikhism. So this is really what's happening for 95% of people who say they belong to a tradition. The belief may be sometimes secondary. So when we look only at ideology and text, we're missing a big part of what makes religion important in politics. And it does have a consequence for also the people who have to deal with conflicts, religion, or religion in different political settings, in the sense that we tend, and that's where we would like very much to hear from Peter Mandaville, because Peter Mandaville is part of a new group, working group under the Secretary of State, where for the first time religion is taken seriously in the shaping of U.S. foreign policy. And as part of this subgroup on particularly religion and conflict mitigation, it was clear that there is a lot of challenge to look at religion outside text, outside a sort of top-down vision that you look at what's happening at the head of an institution of a state, and neglecting that sometimes this kind of discourse or positions do not reflect the reality on the ground. Also, not understanding sometimes that some of the texts used by extremists can be used the same way by people who have a complete different goal. I remember a discussion in South Africa with young Muslims who participated in the fight against apartheid with other religious groups. And one of them said, you know, I'm pretty much uncomfortable now to see that the same hadith, the same pieces of the Quran that I used to work with my Jewish and Christian friends to fight against apartheid are now used by people like ISIS. So if the text can be used in different ways, it means that the reason, the variable is not in the text. It is in what we call the context. Of course, the text is part of it, but you have to take into interaction this text in a situation and in the way that people use it. And this is very challenging, not only for scholars, but I would say even for policymakers. How do you make sense of the use of religion, I would say, in Southeast Asia versus the Middle East? And the idea is all the easy thing to do is to export or even sometimes unconsciously project on the situation you have to deal with your own experience with religion. And especially this sharp divide that we have come take for granted between what is secular and what is religious. And the fact that if you belong to a political institution, you should not deal with religion. While sometimes religion is indeed not about the theology, but about social behaviors that you have to take into account in the policy making. And it has also to do with localizing more than, I would say, generalizing the way that religion can be specific. So it means that going to the chaplain, the priest, or the imam will not explain to you what is the role of religion in some social context. Again, because we function on this idea that religion is a small, tiny niche that we can identify in different settings. So you see here the challenges are for both, I would say, scholars and policy makers. And we hope also in the discussion to bring more the difference Europe and US on this challenge. But now I would like to turn the table to my colleagues and friends. So Nora, did I introduce you or not? Oh, I have to do that. Nora is a co-author of the report I mentioned. She was a fellow at the Atlantic, the Transatlantic Academy, and she's a research associate at the Center for International Studies at Oxford. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, and also for organizing this wonderful forum to enable us to share our results with this community here, with the State Department. And what I'm going to do is just very briefly give kind of the skeleton of the report, an overview, kind of an annotated snapshot of some of the chapters very, very quickly. Then I'll talk about my own contribution, which is on the role of Islamism in Turkish politics and foreign policy. And I will actually keep the part of my intervention that is already in the chapter fairly short, because some very interesting developments have happened in Turkey this weekend with kind of game-changing elections that have quite considerable implications for the evolution of Islamism in the country. So I'll focus really on the election results and what it means, and the implications. So very briefly about the report. So the Transatlantic Academy is an academic platform within the policy think tank, the German Marshall Fund. And every year they convene a group of scholars, of six scholars, usually, to address a particular theme. And quite presciently, actually, the topic for this year was religion in the liberal order, which was a fascinating topic for all of us involved. We thought an important important topic. We had no idea quite how topical a subject it was going to be, but of course, events over last summer when ISIS came onto the scene, and then a series of recent attacks, and also the quite amplified use of sort of civilizational slash religious discourse in the programs of kind of populist leaders and emerging powers like Turkey or Russia or India, all led to this topic being quite salient. So the contributors, the six main contributors, were Michael Barnett from George Washington University. He kind of provided an overview. The report's in the back, so feel free to take one when you're done. He kind of provided an overview of the challenges that Western scholars and policymakers face when they try and grapple with religion, that I think is very congruent with what Jocelyn just presented. There's Clifford Bob from Duquesne University. He looked at transnational cooperation between different faith-based groups, often from different religions, and around what issues they mobilize together, what they don't. He kind of somewhat facetiously calls it the Baptist Burqa Coalition. And then there's Sir Michael Lee, who was a scholar at SAIS, Bologna, back in the day, but who has a very august career as in Brussels within the European Commission, and he was trying to think through a new policy for the EU for the MENA region. There's Anne Jenichen. She really brought to the table, she's a scholar at the University of Bremen. She brought to the table this very this transatlantic perspective, comparing this view that this kind of assumption or myth that somehow the US and US foreign policy is very religious, or it was more religious in orientation than that of a secular Europe. She actually found that that's not the case when you look at protection of religious minorities in countries like Egypt, Pakistan, and Burma, where she found that the EU was actually more consistently pushing for protection of religious minorities, although the reason being that it's wrapped up in a human rights promotion agenda, whereas in the US, the relations with these countries are more wrapped up in a security-oriented agenda. And then there's Lucy Nascenzo, he's going to present his own work. We also had some contributions from Bosch, shorter-term Bosch policy fellows, including Janice Stein, who wrote a chapter on ISIS, Evelyn Finger, who talked about her work at Die Zeit magazine in Germany, and Mustafa Akyol, who is a very articulate Turkish journalist. He wrote an interesting piece in the New York Times yesterday on the elections, who wrote about Islam and the liberal order. And so I'm going to take actually Mustafa's piece. It's, you know, we had an interesting conversation. It was a very collaborative enterprise. And actually, just very briefly, I'll say four kind of takeaways that I think at least the core group of six fellows agreed on when with regard to our findings that again, match up with what Jocelyn said. It's that one, religion is out there, it's important, it's something that secularly oriented Western scholars and policymakers have a hard time grappling with, but we need to. That's why the work of Dr. Mandeville at the State Department is also so very welcome. The second point is that there's an assumption to kind of because of the secularist bias, we tend to assume that religion and everything that has to do with faith and belief is somehow a very powerful atavistic force that impels towards violence. And there's this kind of strong association of religion and violence in a lot of the public discourse and the policy discourse, and that empirically is just not true. When you look at the 20th century, at least, and so far into the 21st century, by far it's been secular nationalist and secular totalitarian ideologies that have been the greatest killers, as it were. Yet there is something very interesting happening right now. It's complex, it's hard to explain. There's a lot of variables at play, as you said. But somehow religion has become the new kind of idiom for collective mobilization, for political mobilization in many parts of the world in much the same way that ethnicity was in the 1990s. So we need to come to terms with that. And fourth, that all of these trends working together give politicians material to work with. So religion is out there as a tool, as it were, for political entrepreneurs, which doesn't mean necessarily that you can always say, well, there's, you know, the belief side of things and there's the instrumentalization of religion on the other. They can be very much intertwined, as it may be in the case of, for example, Erdoğan's attitudes towards religion. But that it does have this kind of dual function, and we have to take that, we have to take both seriously. So those were kind of overall takeaways from the report. My own contribution was entitled Islam in Turkey from Muslim Democracy to Islamist Autocracy? And the reason why I asked this was that there were trends in Turkey over the past 2 years in particular, more broadly over the past 10 years, that forced me to ask whether Islam and Islamism in Turkey, and I want to be very precise about the terms that I'm using here, because I've also been struggling with what Jocelyn talked about, this this great gap in the conversation between people who are kind of, you know, Turkey geeks like myself and Middle East studies scholars who are kind of specialists on it, who have a very sort of nuanced conversation, and then this broader use of the term Islamism out there in public discourse that is, you know, quite simplifying and, you know, working hard to bridge it. What I've been doing, this is my takeaway from Mustafa Akyol's piece, is I've developed his typology that he works out in the report, and I've been using this as a heuristic within which to situate my own analysis. And so, you know, I'm paraphrasing and changing some of his categories a bit, but more or less, if you want to think about the relationship between religion and politics in Muslim-majority countries, you can think about the way that secular Muslims think about religion. And by secular Muslims, this could be people who are agnostic, it could be people who are atheistic, but it could also be people who are kind of the Muslim equivalent of high holiday Jews, who engage in certain kind of cultural practices, affirmative practices that fulfill these three B's that you talked about, but are really not very interested in a very prominent role for Islam in public life. Then, along the spectrum, there's Muslim Democrats, and these are folks who, for whom faith is also, and public expression of their faith is a matter of self-determination. And, you know, this is where I read the headscarf debates, for example, to be about wanting to be able to wear and express one's beliefs in public spaces without harassment. And then there's political Islamists. And political Islamists, you know, Islamism is an ism. It's like nationalism, it's like socialism, it's like communism. It's an ideology that emerged in the late 19th, early 20th century in Muslim-majority societies in response to Western encroachment. It seeks, as an ideology, answers in the text in Islamic law, and it tries to greater or lesser extent to implement measures from Islamic law into public life. But as Jocelyn pointed out, that can there's a huge amount of elasticity as to what that can entail. It is simply not true that political, you know, people say that in the case of, for example, the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, people have said it's, you know, one vote, one man, one time. And that's just simply not true. That's just empirically false, because when you look at the case of Turkey, when you look at Tunisia, when you look at Indonesia, you have multiple instances where political Islamists derive their very legitimacy from the ballot box. That's what's so crucial about what's happened in Turkey on Sunday, and it binds them to the ballot box. And so you have, this is kind of the what's been, you know, most of what happens in Turkey is kind of within this spectrum, within this part of the spectrum, the secular Muslims, the Muslim Democrats, and then the political Islamist movement that subscribes to a perhaps majoritarian, perhaps illiberal reading of democracy, but a reading of democracy nonetheless. Then the further along you go, along the Islamist side of the spectrum, you get towards Salafi, more fundamentalist readings, and at the very far end, you have this extremist jihadist form of Islamism that is by far the minority reading within the whole spectrum, but it's the one that gets all the attention and hype. So when I say is Turkey Islamizing, I was asking, is Turkey, where the political center for several years now under the AKP, Justice and Development Party rule, has been sort of in the Muslim democratic space, has that been swinging more and more towards the political Islamist space or not? My findings were, I looked at sort of key areas of political Islamist governance, I looked at education, I looked at policies on gender, and I looked at the role of the Directorate of Religious Affairs, and there was I saw penetration and a growing role, especially in the past 2 years, of policies and that were impelling towards Islamicization in the sense of introducing measures into public life that are inspired by readings of Islamic texts and tradition. And had the results on Sunday turned out differently, then that might have continued in an accelerated fashion. However, as many of you may know, there's been some fascinating general elections in Turkey. They were intended by President Recep Tayyip Erdoğan to be a sort of a mandate for converting the country from a parliamentary style democracy to sort of an executive presidency. Hotly contested elections, and the Turkish public, including AKP voters, basically pushed back with a resounding no. We do not want an executive presidency. We want to keep our parliamentary system. It's really a fascinating result. So just quickly to kind of go through, what happened? How can we, when we look at the maps now explaining the electoral outcomes across the country, who said no to what? At one level, there's the sort of the bread and butter issues at play that any party, whether it had been Erdoğan and the AKP or, Erdoğan and any other kind of political movement, there's the incumbent factor. There's the fact that they were in power for 3 terms, 12 years, and voters get tired of that. There was the bread and butter factor in that the economy is not going as well as it has been in recent years. There's no crisis brewing, but it has been some of the spectacular growth rates of the late 2000s, early 2010s have tapered off. And Turkey's were kind of falling into this middle income trap. So there was that economic response. There was a typical foreign policy pushback. Overall, across the Turkish electorate, there's quite a bit of ambivalence about Turkey's Syria policy because it's not seen, the threat of ISIS is very much felt by in many segments of the public, and it's not seen to be, they're watching very uncomfortably at what's happening across the border. But then there was also the Erdoğan factor, right? The fact that there was this very charismatic, very overbearing personality who was trying to fill up as much space within the political system as possible, and in many ways was kind of treating Turkey as if it was a banana republic. And the Turkish voters responded with a great deal of sophistication by voting strategically for a party that the pro-Kurdish party in order to help it. I mean, it's kind of technical, but it was basically in order to help push a party that is normally a single issue and minor party over the electoral threshold in order to basically veto the executive presidency option. And that was done by both pro-secular voters who weren't voting for the AKP or for Erdoğan anyway, and it was done by Kurds, religious Kurds, who used to vote for the AKP, who sided heavily with the HDP this time as a result of actually overall Kurdish disillusionment with the AKP's peace process after Ankara's inaction on Kobani back in the fall. So there's that Kurdish factor as well. And then the AKP also lost votes from religious Sunni Muslims from central Anatolia, which is normally the AKP heartland, who were resistant to the Kurdish peace process for other reasons, and who are also just a bit disappointed with this whole clash that has happened between Mr. Erdoğan and the preacher Fethullah Gülen and his movement that has been the source of a series of huge controversies, corruption allegations, and kind of a lot of dirty laundry being aired in Turkish politics that left a lot of the kind of centrist, pious, Sunni Turkish Muslim voter a bit disappointed. So that's another place where they lost votes. And then there's another source of the lost votes was what I call these, it's not a new voting bloc in Turkey, but it was the people, you may have noticed if any of you, follow Turkey fairly closely, over the past 2-3 years, there's been, a lot of protests, a lot of demonstrations all the time. It seems like someone's protesting in Turkey about something. And these were groups that had been, felt really disenfranchised under under the increasingly kind of heavy-handed and Islamicizing policies of the Erdoğan-driven government. And they include youth, and they include religious youth. It's not just pro-secular youth. It's also urban millennials whose parents who've been empowered under Erdoğan's economic program, who've been empowered under the, you know, the transformation that Turkey has undergone in the past 10 years, whose parents probably still voted for the AKP. But they themselves, I mean, we have statistics that show that for the under 23 cohort, so people are kind of, the introduction to politics has been in this electoral cycle. Only 29% voted for the AKP compared to 41% for the nationwide average, and 24% voted for the HDP. So you had a real, the HDP leader was able to, you know, kind of really articulate this kind of millennial zeitgeist about kind of politics of mutual recognition, about you know, Sunni and Alevi, Turk and Kurd, the privileged and the subaltern, about them, all of these groups being able to come together under one wing. And that really appealed to Turkey's youth, which is really important for trends in the future, because in 2020, Turkey will have the largest population in Europe. It will outstrip Germany, and it will have the largest youth population in Europe, average age 29, I think. So there's the youth votes. There's also women played a very important role, not only in taking votes away from the AKP, but in also impelling the pro-Kurdish party and the pro-secular party to change their style of politics. So, for example, we see this in the candidates that they field. This parliament will have the largest representation of women that of any Turkish parliament in Republican history, almost 18%. It was only 8%, I think, in the last parliament. It will have in addition to women, Alevis. So this is a Muslim minority in Turkey, about 8 to 10 million people. They have affinities with Syrian Alawites, but very kind of distinctly, it's a distinctly Anatolian tradition. It's very, in Western terminology, it looks secular from the outside. It's more kind of, think of it sort of like mystic, sort of Sufi type of dimension, but they don't believe in the tenets of Sunni Islam are obligatory. So they don't believe you need to fast in Ramadan, for example. They don't believe you need to pray five times a day. They don't believe in I get so excited about this. It's such a fascinating.
We can do a whole discussion.
So anyway, in a nutshell, these groups have really mobilized and shown that there's other actually kind of pro-religious voters who've sent a message as well by moving away from the AKP. But we can come to that in the discussion.
Thank you. So I will turn to Lucien. Rostan is also a contributor to the report, and with senior lecturer in politics and international relations at Aston Birmingham University of Birmingham, right?
Aston University in Birmingham, United Kingdom.
There are so many there.
Yeah, either way, I said we have three universities in Birmingham, that's one of them. Anyway, I would like to start by thanking you for being here, and thanking the Berkley Center and the Transatlantic Academy for organizing the event. This is our last official event, so we've reached the end of the fellowship, so it's great to be here in an academic environment. Thank you for putting this together. Just a few words about my chapter and the report as well. Basically, my chapter dealt with Eastern Christianity and the liberal international order. And just to remind you what exactly this Eastern Christianity is. So if you look at Christianity, you have three main branches. So it's Roman Catholicism, Protestantism, and then Eastern Christianity. And I would like to start with a few remarks on the report and how exactly it relates to that. So basically the fellows met at least once a week. We discussed many times, we came as many times even through every sentence. What do you mean by that? Is it the right sentence? Is it the right wording? In the end, it's a collaborative work, but it's also our own individual work. So very much appreciate the discussions we had. When you read the report, have in mind that this is for both academics, but also for policymakers. So that's that kind of combination. And Jocelyn, you started with a quotation from Stalin. Just to give you an idea, I would like also to start with a quotation, but a more recent quotation. So we submitted the chapters for publications at the beginning of April. So my quotation is from a periodical. It's an interview that took place a few weeks later. So it's in a way, it's like you work for the whole year and then you wonder, am I going in the right direction or not? Are the policymakers actually interested in this, or am I saying completely crazy things that nobody will, don't have anything to do with reality? So I had a very nice surprise to see there was an interview in this periodical. The periodical is called La Civita, Civita Cattolica. So it's published in Rome, some of you know, but just a reminder, it's a periodical published in Rome twice a month by the Jesuit order. And why it's so important, it reflects, I mean, although you have individual articles, it reflects the position of the whole editorial board as a whole. And it's the only journal that, although does not have, is not the official voice of the Holy See, the actual text is approved by the Secretariat of the Holy See. So the wording there, that's what I want to emphasize, the wording in this journal is particularly important. And why, I said, the quotation now. So there was an interview with the Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew I was based in Istanbul, and they asked me many, many things, but at one point they asked him why he attended the enthronement of Pope Francis just a few years ago, because this was unprecedented. So you have, I said, different branches of Christianity. You have in Rome and Constantinople, Istanbul, and for the first time since 1054, when you have the separations between these two branches, you have Patriarch Bartholomew actually going to Rome and attending the ceremony. So they ask him, why did you go there? So let's see the quotation now. The protos, or the first, is the one who seeks for the consensus of everyone. From the very outset of the election of Pope Francis, we felt that there was something special about him. His integrity, his spontaneity, his worth. This is why we decided to attend his installation. I mean, this may sound something like, something that you read in the newspapers many times. But I think there are two words here that we have to take into account. First one is consensus. And the second one, I try to emphasize, is we felt. I mean, when you speak about church leaders, it's not the word felt is not the right term to actually use, in a sense that imagine Patriarch Kirill, for example, of Moscow, saying in an interview, I felt that I would like to meet Pope Francis. It's not that you actually feel, yes, it's not about what you feel. You have to take into account the history, the relations, who you represent. So I thought that the word felt is not the right word to use. However, what I would like to emphasize, basically it stresses, it emphasizes the political and the religious, the unique religious and political environment we live in. And the report and my chapter, in a way, deals with this. He was also asked about a new event that's going to take place next year, which is called the 2016 Synod of Orthodox Churches, and I will come back in a minute to that. So he said he was asked in the interview, will this synod take place? So he said the patriarch replies that I hope it will take place, and it will be something useful for all the churches. And then he also, just a quotation, I hope the churches will be there rather than becoming fixed on self-seeking and self-serving interests of power and privilege. So he doesn't name exactly which are those churches that may seem to be more interested on this interest of power or privilege, but he gives you an idea that there is tension, there is a difficulty between churches in the Eastern Christian world. And this is something that I try to deal in my report. Just a few ideas, a few very short summary on the findings. So you have an idea how does the relationship between religion, between churches and politics in the Eastern Christian world actually relate to? So the first one is it's a Byzantine concept of symphonia, where you have very close relationship between the church and the state. Sometimes the lines between the church and the state are unclear. It goes back to the theory of imperium, sacerdotium, the relationship between body and soul, or hierosina, basilia. So it's very unclear what exactly is the church, what exactly is the state, what's the political, what's the religious. So that's you have to take into account when you look at the Eastern Christian world. That's the first thing. Another thing is that you have to look at the persecution of churches in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union under communism, and how these churches emerged, sometimes under various jurisdictions. Churches that were in exile suddenly came back to the Eastern Europe. Look at Estonia, for example. And they claimed, or Ukraine, they claimed new situations, and it's a new political environment, a new regime that you have to take into account. In the long term, those who had a very close relationship, the churches which had close relationship with the regime, they emerged more powerful and stronger. And overall, after 1989, the Eastern Christian world has been dominated by tensions between Constantinople, Istanbul, and Moscow. So now go back to the synod that I mentioned a few minutes ago. At the time of Russia's takeover of Crimea, it was in March 2014, a meeting took place in Istanbul, a rather unusual meeting with the heads, with the primates of all Orthodox churches. And they decided, I said, that in 2006, next year, we should have this synod. And the synod is considered as, by some scholars, may be perceived as the eighth ecumenical council in the Orthodox world that goes back to the 8th century. And this synod has been in preparation since the 1920s. So you have to take into account what time when it was announced, the long-term impact, why at that time was it just for the critics to alleviate criticism or not, and what exactly they are going to discuss is just going to be a meeting. They have 10 issues that they want to discuss. It's still unclear at this very moment what exactly would be those final issue. But one of the major points, if they address this, is diaspora, which means the Orthodox Church in America, is it going to be recognized as an independent church? Or are we going to have new churches? So for the whole structure of Eastern Christian world, this synod is very important. So that's the synod. In the chapter, coming closer to a conclusion, in the chapter, I also address the relationship the main challenges that the relationship between Eastern Christian world and political regimes we have to take into account. So the first one, I thought, is the idea of an Orthodox civilization. You have this immediately after 1989, some of the points already mentioned in Huntington, but you have many churchmen, many politicians believing that what's happening in the East, it's a unique Orthodox civilization challenging the secular decadent West. So that's, I have to take that into account. And this, your Orthodox civilization brings something new. Second challenge is the survival of churches in the Middle East, and we will have that in some of the points later. Many times you read in the newspapers how many Christians are in Iraq or Syria. Are we going to see any Christian communities in the future or not? The third challenge is the relationship between Orthodox churches and European institutions and European Union as a whole. You have some politicians, for example, or to an extreme, for example, let's give a quotation from Alexander Dugin, as promoter of Eurasianism, saying that nation states as we know them should completely disappear and a Eurasian empire should be spread from Vladivostok up to Austria. So where exactly the European Union will fit in this? And the last point is the synod, which is going to take place next year. So these are the four main challenges. You'll find more details in the report, and I hope that you will find it useful. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I would like to introduce Evelyn Finger, who is a religion editor of the weekly newspaper in Germany called Die Zeit. And you will talk about the political treatment of ISIS in Europe.
Oh, yes, good idea.
And Evelyn is not a contributor to the report, right?
No, I'm a just short-term fellow with Transatlantic Academy, visiting for 1 month in Washington. And I can say that I was very grateful that my stay here started with a conference at Georgetown University. So this was not planned for my transatlantic stay here. But this wonderful conference that you did on Vatican II and the challenges for the future. So on the one hand, about the unity of Christians, and on the other hand, of interreligious dialogue. It was a great start for this day here. And the reason why I came up to Georgetown University is closely connected with the work that I do for my newspaper, because I knew about the conference by Cardinal Kasper, who has become a very important partner for us after the new Pope was elected. And this is for sure one of the big topics in the religion field that I have to cover all the time. And I think most of you will know that Kasper and others belong to the supporters of the reforms in Rome taking place under Pope Francis now. So, maybe I can shortly explain that a religion desk, or a desk on faith and doubt, how we call it, is not normal to have for a big newspaper, also in Germany. So we founded this desk that I have the pleasure to be responsible for 5 years before, because we had the feeling that religion does matter again in a way that was sort of unexpected. And when we planned and started this special desk, we thought the desk would deal a lot with more ethical and also theoretical topics like religion in a postmodern era. For as you know, we have these discussions a lot in Europe, and the situation is a bit different from here and then from other parts of the world too. But it turned out that this desk became very political because of all the things going on in the world. So from the changes in the Catholic Church and the big debates about the future of Catholic Church on the one hand, and the other extreme, that is ISIS now. So on the very weekend when I came over and attended this wonderful conference here, There was something else that kept me busy. I had to prepare the next edition of my page for at home. And on that very weekend, there was the attack on Palmyra by the Islamic State. And I'm pretty sure you read about it in the newspapers. And I just want to take the example of Palmyra to make a few comments on it from the perspective of a journalist. So I will not pretend to be an academic in your field. I better don't. On Palmyra as a predictable catastrophe. So I don't know if you still remember an early horrific video circulated by Syrian jihadists almost 1 year before. That was long before James Foley was beheaded. That was before the forced migrations, mass shootings, mass rapes caused by Islamic State. And that video showed a so-called fighter ripping another man's heart from his chest. Perhaps it's the surreal nature of such extreme taboo-breaking acts that has now prompted the United Nations to express its outrage over Palmyra and the Islamic State officially, as if something this horrific were not happening, were happening for the first time now. And I'm sure you all read about the Islamic State militants who murdered hundreds of residents, including children, on that weekend when they approached Palmyra, and the corpses were thrown onto the streets and defiled, etc. But and everybody, also in the press, reacted on this attack as if we were shocked, and of course we are shocked, but on the other hand, it was possible to predict this catastrophe. Anyone who wanted to could have seen the advance on Palmyra coming, as did the archaeologists who have been issuing warnings for months. So I can perhaps tell you that we had a large interview in March already with one archaeologist who was responsible for the excavations in Palmyra for 30 years, a German professor. And when Khorsabad, Hatra, and the other attacks on ancient places took place, he was warning that the next spot would be Palmyra, and if he knows it, decision makers in policy should know it too, but nothing happened, and then we had the next case. So anyone who wanted to also could have predicted the atrocities directed at civilians, as did the aid organizations and representative of religious minorities in Iraq, who have been pleading for peacekeeping troops for months. I want to look back on this earlier video to explain something about this predictable catastrophes that are somehow ignored as long as they don't take place. For not only does this video display an ultimate act of violence, but it also tries to justify it, which is important. We can see the murderer bending over his victim, who's lying on the floor still alive and slices out a red chunk with a knife. And he holds the man's heart high in triumph and then brings it to his mouth as if to kiss it. And he shouts, "God is great." So this was a warning and a declaration, and it was originally uploaded onto the internet by a Syrian fighter who claimed to have murdered a Syrian soldier, and he said, "I swear to Allah that we will eat your hearts and livers, soldiers of the Dog Bashar." It was unclear at the time whether he was a fighter of al-Nusra or IS, since both groups were primarily primarily fighting against the Syrian president and not against each other. And clear, however, was the message: the murders we commit are legitimate. Even then, horrified Muslims and non-Muslims protested against the use of religion to legitimize such acts. But for IS fighters, who see themselves as enforcers of the one true Islam, this is the force that drives them. But sadly, the strategy of legitimization have barely been analyzed, at least in Europe, in the public. Instead, public debate has concentrated in Europe and especially in Germany on defending Islam from the militant Islamists. Yes, it's obvious that the self-acclaimed Islamic State is not the Islam. But reinforcing this point was not enough. And we are sort of sometimes stuck in this debate, I can say, at least in Germany, also when it comes to discussions about our responsibility to protect. And so we fail in analyzing a decisive force for further violence. And covering these topics all the time, I'm very concerned about this lack of analysis, I must say. So sorry for my bad English. I try to make it so. There's a German-Egyptian political scientist, Hamed Abdel Samad. He's a former Muslim brother, but he's not with them anymore. Already presented a broader analysis of the caliphate's totalitarian ideology back in June 2014. And he explained not only the old motive of beheadings, but also that of ripping out a heart. So it's not about like there's just crazy things going on, but there's a pattern. And according to Abdel Samad, it originates from the early era of Islam in the 7th century, when Hamza, the Prophet Muhammad's uncle, died fighting in the Muslim war against the Meccans. And a woman from the Quraysh tribe in Mecca ripped Hamza's liver from his dead body and ate it. And when Muhammad saw his uncle's corpse after the battle, he swore, "If Allah helps me to triumph over Quraysh, I will mutilate 30 of their corpses." So, with this in mind, the latest mutilations of corpses in Palmyra and the atrocities committed against women and children are not so surprising. They are part of a program, and this program is on the table since the Caliph Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi gave his large speech, right? Like 1 year, I think it's nearly exactly 1 year ago. So for 1 year or so, a question has thus been asked to the United Nations and to the European Union. Do we feel it is our responsibility to protect declared enemies? And that means potential victims of IS? Or do we only discuss it after it had happened? So, if international politics wish to react appropriately to IS terror, it should be aware of such religious motives instead of merely defending the religion against its extremist interpreters. It is not enough to complain that IS is abusing Islam. Of course it does. But one has also to understand how. And maybe this is a bit different here in America, because we have the US airstrikes in Iraq at the moment that prevented much more victims of IS. So you probably remember how IS approached Erbil, where most of the refugees are based at the moment. And then in the end, luckily, IS didn't make it to Erbil because the Peshmerga were supported by the American airstrikes, right? And I'm very aware of the fact that you have a big discussion about intervention here after the Iraq war. But from European perspective, where we sit back and do nothing at all, I would say big mistakes in the past are not an excuse for the opposite mistakes in the present. But yeah, I'm pretty sure this is controversial. So for a long time, jihad has been misunderstood in the West as a war against the Western world. This is one thing we try to show now in connection with IS. This misconception became manifest when the Al-Qaeda attack on the World Trade Center on 9/11 took place. Because jihad, the holy war, is a battle not only against the West, but against all enemies of God. That means whoever is declared an enemy by the current jihadists means, in this case, the Islamic State is an enemy. So last summer, IS were already circulating videos in which the beheading of enemy Muslims were shown. And to accompany the videos, the extremists quoted Muhammad saying, "I have come to you as a warrior." And also very popular was a surah. It's 47.2. It says, "If you meet those who are unbelievers, strike them on the neck." So unbelievers here means those adhering to false Islam. And this motive is well known too from the secular totalitarianism of the 20th century. The greatest enemy is the enemy within. And so this is one of the reasons why I think when we analyze militant fundamentalism today, we should not forget what we learned from analyzing totalitarianism in the 20th century over decades. It's not just for political, but also religious reasons that IS is now overwhelmingly fighting against Shiites too. So indeed, the division between the two branches of the religion dates back to the 7th century, but I will not explain this thing, maybe it takes too long. And I'd go to two more points and then finish this. I just want to remind you that even Sunni Muslims are killed by IS at the moment. So for example, again, in the case of attacking these ancient sites like in Khorsabad, Hatra, or Palmyra, of course, the Sunni guards of these places were killed because they were considered to protect un-Islamic heritage in the eyes of the Islamic States, of course. And archaeologists who have worked there for a long time, they now report very sadly on the times when, at least they say it, to the times when everybody was working there together so closely. So they tell us today that it didn't matter if you were a Muslim or a Christian or even a Jew. But this has changed a lot in the area, and the people who are the victims today, they doubt that they can return to their homelands, even if the war would be finished. So, and maybe one thing that might not be so much on the table here, that is important for understanding what happened in Palmyra and also before, is something else that IS is approaching the sites not only to destroy but also to steal ancient art, to trade it also to the West. And this is one fact we have also known for a long time and didn't do anything about it. And the experts in the field warn us about this. And still we have no laws in the West to provide this sort of art being sold. Well, I will go a bit back to come to one conclusion. So, in Europe, maybe this is one last interesting point. In Europe, criticism of previous American interventions in Iraq has long since become an excuse for Europe's own, not only in action, but also for hesitating, having a real debate in which respect we are responsible to protect victims. And only the churches in Europe, I must say, are demanding military protected zones for those in Iraq who were forced to flee from IS at the moment. But the advance of IS in Iraq and Syria has an impact on the cultural identity of the East as well as of the West. Moreover, it impacts civilians and children too. So why then are the European Union and the United Nations now declaring their outrage only after over Palmyra and other attacks of IS? And why is the Western media outraged after months of automatically filtering out the perpetrators' gruesome videos in more or less the same way like Facebook and Google delete inappropriate content? So why are we hiding the truth that we know, and we don't show it in the media very often? We don't show all the pictures that we have, because we are just frightened to face a real complex problem on the one hand, perhaps because of serious concerns over intervention also, for sure, but also because maybe because of the conviction that Syria and Iraq have nothing to do with us. But if we believe this, then we should spare our public outrage, because moral outrage without the intention of taking moral action is hypocrisy. And so this is one thing we are very concerned about in Europe at the moment. Thank you very much.
So I'm turning to Peter Mandeville, who has a heavy charge to respond. We had until now a debate really on how to address religion in the academic field and make it relevant for policy making. And so I would like to introduce you as an academic first, Professor of International Relations at George Mason University and Senior Advisor. And this brand new office on religion and global affairs at the US Department that is also leading this working group I mentioned before. So Peter, the floor is yours for 15 minutes.
Thank you very much, Jocelyn. My sincere apologies for my late arrival. And I want to thank the Berkley Center, you know, who's been an enduring resource and partner and source of advice and constructive criticism to our office as it's been established. And of course, it's been such an enormous treat to have the German Marshall Fund's Transatlantic Academy spend a year focusing on the question of religion and foreign policy, just as our office was kind of developing its operational capacity. And so having the opportunity to interact on an ongoing and regular basis over this past year with the fellows has just been a huge help to us. I want to talk briefly about our office, what it is, what it does, how it does what it does, but then to also, I think, respond briefly to each of the three speakers who I think have raised areas of significant challenge for our office. I think each of them in different ways points fingers at ongoing ambiguities and complexities that have to be dealt with and addressed any time a modern bureaucratic entity, such as a diplomatic apparatus, tries to wrap its head around a phenomenon such as religion. You know, our office was established, as Jocelyn said, quite recently in 2013, shortly after Secretary of State Kerry came into office. But on the back of a longer running set of conversations that had been going on in the State Department that date back to Secretary Clinton's time and even before, I guess driven by a recognition that religion is an enormously important force in societies around the world, but one that is not typically on the radar of diplomatic agencies, one that does not necessarily always enter into discussions of how you do diplomacy more effectively, other than to perhaps serve as a challenge or a source of problems and a source of danger. The Secretary of State set up our office within his own office. So we belong to the Secretary of State, and in that sense, we have a department-wide mandate to build awareness and capacity across the full range of functions that the State Department carries out, a greater awareness and a greater capacity of religion and the question of how engagement with the religious sector in countries around the world, religious leaders, religious institutions, can serve as a way to advance U.S. foreign policy and national security objectives. You know, we are not the first entity at the State Department to have the word religion in our title, and this has been a source of ongoing confusion to some extent, even to our colleagues in the building. As many of you know, since the late 1990s, there has been an Office of International Religious Freedom at the State Department that was created by an act of Congress, the International Religious Freedom Act of 1998, that is focused on the question of how to advance religious freedom as a human rights value around the world. That office is therefore quite appropriately lodged within the bureau in the State Department that deals with human rights and has that rather narrower function. Our office, while we, for obvious reasons, talk to and coordinate quite closely with the international religious freedom folks, you know, our function is quite different insofar as, you know, we're asking the question of how can U.S. diplomats, regardless of whether they work on rule of law issues, whether they work on development and, you know, entrepreneurship and small business cultivation work in Ecuador and in Indonesia, regardless of what you do as a diplomat, how can gaining a better understanding of religion as a force in the country where you work and engagement with religious leaders, how can you add these to the diplomatic toolkit when trying to do whatever you do? I think it's been the case that where discussions of religion have entered into diplomatic conversations in recent years, religion has often served as a shorthand or euphemism for a set of discussions that are really about Islam and really about sort of terrorism and issues of security. One of the key motivating forces behind the establishment of our office, therefore, was to try and broaden the conversation about religion so that it wasn't confined simply to discussions of one religious tradition and wasn't simply focused on questions of security and terrorism. That said, those are issues that we do work on very closely. I was brought on board to lead a team within our office focused on leading one dimension of the U.S. strategy against ISIS, and in that regard, questions of Islam and security are very much my daily bread and butter these days. But the sorts of things that our office works on are very diverse, and you know, I'll in a moment I'll sort of enumerate some of the policy issues that we're working on. Officially, our office has three functions. One is a policy advising and shaping function, which is about, you know, helping our colleagues to understand where religion fits into what they do, and how certain kinds of understandings and assumptions about where religion fits into things can shape the way that we make policy. Second is a capacity building function, which is the part about helping our diplomats at US embassies around the world, at our consulates, at our various posts, to gain a better understanding of how the religious sector, the religious landscape, as we call it, in the country in which they operate, is something that they need to understand, and more specifically, to understand the interface between the religious sector and broader aspects of society, politics, economy, culture, society more broadly, in order to be able to kind of activate alternative channels of engaging and working on the issues that they try and advance. We also serve as a point of direct engagement. We have, even in the short time that we've been in existence, I think, you know, we tried to sort of count the number of meetings we've had with religious leaders, religious organizations, faith-based communities of various kinds, and kind of lost count at 1,000 a few months back. I think it's fair to say that the establishment of our office has been heartily welcomed by religious communities who have, I think, often hesitated to engage with diplomatic bodies because they felt that there's a sort of disconnect between the way that official government agencies view and engage the world, and I'll say more about that in a moment, specifically when responding to the comments, the very interesting remarks that Lucien made, a sort of misfit between their worldview and the worldview of sort of elite bureaucratic entities like the State Department. And I think they've welcomed the opportunity that there is someone such as our principal in our office, Special Representative Sean Casey, you know, who comes from a background of theology and is simply able to engage these groups in a kind of conversation that isn't usually possible when they knock on the door of the U.S. State Department. In performing these three functions, I think it's possible to divide the kind of approach that we take into three kinds of themes to help people understand what we're trying to do. And those three themes are normalizing, right-sizing, and mainstreaming. The normalizing function is about, and here I can't help but sort of reflect something that Evelyn said in her comments, that in a sense it's strange to have a religion desk at a newspaper. Likewise, it's strange to have a religion office in the State Department. And many of our colleagues look at our office and scratch their heads and say, "Who are you people and what are you doing?" But you know, part of that is a function of the legacy of modern diplomacy and the assumptions that underpin the conduct of international relations, right? That religion as a quote-unquote cultural force is not part of realpolitik. It's not about the hardcore geopolitical, particularly security interests that drive international affairs. And so it's almost something superfluous. You don't have to really pay much attention to it. I think that's part of the neglect. Second, I think, is frankly a function of the underlying culture of modern bureaucratic elite entities. The question of whether there is something like a secular bias within modern bureaucratic institutions, and you know, that's a much more complex question that we don't really have scope to get into, but I think there is something to that. And finally, among some of our colleagues, even those who sort of have recognized the importance of religion as a force around, you know, around the world, the idea that the government, and the U.S. government in particular, would and should lean into that space is something constrained by the U.S. Constitution, that there are good legal reasons because of the First Amendment and the Establishment Clause that mean that the U.S. government should keep some distance from becoming involved in matters of theology or appearing to take particular positions with respect to religion, which are legitimate concerns to have. As you can imagine, our office spends a lot of time ruminating on and feeling our way around the red lines and boundaries of the Establishment Clause. Although to our minds, it's actually a very important tool, and it's a very important thing to have, rather than something that we view as a legal framework that gets in the way of what we want to do. It actually, I think, helps us do the things we need to do better, and I'm happy to kind of talk about that. The right-sizing piece of our function, I think, is about, on the one hand, disabusing some of our colleagues who might think that we're the pro-religion office, you know, and that our office is full of people who are very religious and want to stick religion into everything. Quite the opposite. We spend a lot of time trying to pull people away from religion. And what I mean by that is we have many colleagues in the office who will look at a given situation in the world and assume that religion is the root cause and the main driving force. And we actually have to spend a lot of time helping them understand that, you know, yes, there is a religious dimension to this, but if you're actually trying to understand the root causes, you may want to look elsewhere. And that's kind of what I mean by right-sizing religion. It's not about always trying to put religion into every issue that the State Department deals with. It's also about trying to help our colleagues to have a better and more accurate understanding of where religion does fit into a given situation. And finally, there's this kind of function that we call mainstreaming, which is to, again, reinforce the idea that, you know, religion is not just people who work, is not something that only has to be focused on by diplomats who work on very specific issues, i.e. the Muslim world or security and terrorism, but that regardless of where you sit in our building, being able to understand religion as a key component of civil society in whatever countries you're doing your work is something that has the potential to help advance your mission and your work. The sorts of issues we've worked on since our founding in 2013 have been very wide and varied. Certainly, they have involved things that you would expect: the Middle East peace process, the work that I lead on ISIS and sectarianism, particularly in Iraq. But also, one of our signature issues has been climate change, and the question of the role that religious communities and faith-based organizations can play, you know, perhaps coming from a different perspective, from a different point of departure, but the idea that these groups have a key role to play in international movements and coalitions to combat climate change, and that the resources and capacities and social reach that these communities and groups have are a neglected facet that we need to tap into. We've also been involved in the Ukraine, you know, understanding that the Orthodox churches involved in that context have potentially a key role to play in shaping some of the possible futures of that particular conflict. Finally, I just wanted to say a brief word about how each of the presentations we've heard so far, I think, very nicely frame some of the key challenges that our office faces. Nora's, I think, very astute exposition of Islamism in Turkey, understood and read against the broader backdrop of Western governments' engagement with political Islam over the last few decades, I think, throws up a couple of quandaries that we face. One is, frankly, a definitional one, and it's a question about the scope that our office has. You know, a group such as the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, is this to be understood as a religious actor and therefore something that fits within our mandate, or should it be understood primarily as a normal political party that operates within a particular country, Egypt, and therefore it's the responsibility of our Bureau of Near Eastern Affairs to figure out how to deal with that issue? I don't think that there's an easy and clear answer to that question, and there's also not an easy and clear answer within current U.S. policy. During my previous tour of duty at the State Department in 2011, my main role was to help shape U.S. policy towards Islamist parties in the aftermath of the revolutions in Tunisia and Egypt. And the approach that we took then was very much one of seeking to sort of normalize these groups. And in that sense, it does fall in line with the normalization paradigm that I've talked about. Because I think there was the assumption that because religion is present somewhere in the motivations, the worldview, the agenda of these groups, that they somehow don't fit the paradigm of normal politics and can't be treated as normalized political actors, despite the fact that even by then there was a significant track record of the participation of such groups in mainstream politics in a number of countries, and plenty of evidence that for the most part, when operating within formalized political systems, they behaved largely as normal political actors. I think it's that track record that made it possible for the immediate aftermath of the rise to prominence of groups like Ennahda in Tunisia and the Ikhwan al-Muslimin, the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, it helped my colleagues at the time to feel comfortable that, okay, these groups are just part and parcel of how politics is done now, and we need to kind of figure out how to do business with them. That situation, of course, has been rendered very complicated by ensuing events, not just the intractable nature of the civil war in Syria, the rise of ISIS, the events in Egypt in 2013, the changing political fortunes of Ennahda in Tunisia, and I think a tendency on the part of the U.S. government to revert, in some regards for very understandable reasons, to a kind of security and stability footing, which I think has led to a tendency on the part of my colleagues to emphasize the need to maintain good relations with those countries in the region where we have incredibly close security cooperation around issues of counterterrorism and a whole range of other dimensions that have a huge impact on our ability to do something like put together and effectively run a global coalition to counter ISIS that has a military dimension to it. And it's no secret that this priority right now has made it difficult for us to continue to pursue the trajectory with regard to mainstream nonviolent Islamism that we set in 2011. That said, there has been no formal change in the U.S. policy towards groups like the Muslim Brotherhood. We're aware that the Egyptian government has pursued an approach that seeks to brand these groups as criminals and terrorists, and the U.S. government does not agree with and rejects that kind of designation. The United States has no reason and sees no evidence to designate a group such as the Muslim Brotherhood as a terrorist organization. That doesn't mean, however, that there are not ongoing complications with respect to how the U.S. relates to such groups. I think Lucien's remarks, I think, very aptly frame one of the key challenges we face when dealing with the religious sector, religious actors, in that there's to some extent a mismatch, a dissonance between what you might call, let me characterize it in this way, a discrepancy in temporality, right? That ecclesiastical time and American standard political time, APST, whatever that is, are not necessarily in sync with each other. That the sort of cosmology of Symphonia and the cosmology of Westphalia are not in sync with each other, right? And so when you engage actors in the world that operate with these discrepant conceptions of what it's all about and where humanity and society is going, that are not, part and parcel of the standard Washington policy debate, it makes it hard to have these conversations. And I think that's one of the reasons why in the past there's just been hesitancy to engage with these groups. thankfully, Sean Casey is a very patient man and is quite happy to operate on ecclesiastical standard time. You know, that's what he learned from the divinity school. Absolutely. And then, you know, I think the remarks and presentation that Evelyn made about ISIS and how we understand and think about where religion fits there, I think nicely encapsulates a huge challenge that our office has faced. You know, I came into the State Department at around the exact time that this now infamous article by Graham Wood appeared in The Atlantic, What ISIS Really Wants, right, that made the case that, you know, this is all about religion, and we're failing to understand that these guys take religion very seriously and that everything they do is grounded in religion. And there are a lot of problems with that article. And in some ways, I actually think that the central thrust of the article was misunderstood. And people sort of started to do things with the article to make certain points that they wanted to make. But it certainly was an article that crystallized a debate that had been going on, certainly within policymaking circles, about how do we think about religion in the context of ISIS, and more specifically, how should the United States, how should the strategy against ISIS think about the role of religion? Is this something that we should engage with, you know, in the context of trying to deal with ISIS? I would say that our office, this has probably been one space where our office has tried to play more the role of pull religion out and stay away. Precisely because, you know, when we started our counter-ISIS work, I think there was a lot of hope amongst our colleagues at the State Department and elsewhere in the U.S. government that deal with counter-messaging and narratives, that we would be able to tell them, you know, exactly what fatwas need to be retweeted this week to, you know, somehow defeat ISIS. And our perspective was to say, no, the United States government needs to stay well away from religion and theology. We have no standing or credibility in that regard. The U.S. government has no positionality from which to pronounce upon what is Islamic in any sense, much less whether what Daesh does is Islamic or not. You know, if we spend a lot of time pointing to religious leaders that are saying, quote unquote, the right things, you know, most likely we're simply going to discredit them as messengers. So we need to stay away from that as well. That doesn't mean that you don't spend time trying to analyze the means, the modalities, the patterns through which ISIS interpolates religion into what they do. It doesn't mean you don't try to understand where and how religion operates as a factor in foreign fighter recruitment, so that you can design strategies and approaches to that are, again, appropriately sized with respect to religion. But, you know, our approach generally has been to kind of say that you know, the U.S. government needs to stay away from this, and our approach really is to say, look, debating Daesh and the finer points of its ideology and its religious justifications is really missing the root causes of what's going on here. The root causes of sectarian tension in Iraq right now are driven by decades and centuries old political and economic tensions between minority demographics, minority majoritarian demographics. Indeed, in our analysis, the root causes here look more like the conflict in Northern Ireland, right? Which on the face of it was supposedly between two sects, right? Catholics and Protestants. Does anyone really think the conflict in Northern Ireland was primarily about differences over theology? Of course not. That doesn't mean that certain religious actors in that country didn't try to use religion as a wedge point, but at the end of the day, we know that that was primarily about differential communal access to economic opportunity and political power and voice. Likewise, what's going on in Iraq today, at root, right? The thing that allowed Daesh to so spectacularly enter Iraq last summer and seize so much territory so quickly was the fact that there had been, over years, growing tensions and suspicion between different demographic groups in the country about who's involved, who's enfranchised, and who isn't. So for us, in an approach to engaging religion towards dealing with Daesh is not about tinkering with theology or trying to understand theology. It's asking questions about how religious leaders can help to, at the communal and grassroots level, build trust between communities that are suspicious of each other, that have legitimate grievances in ways that allow for a bedrock of trust, or a ground bed of trust that will enable or increase the likelihood that the official process of national reconciliation and political settlement finds fertile ground. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. So we have 15 minutes. So I'm going to give a few questions, ask participants to respond, not automatically all of them, and then at least two rounds, I think. Yes. If you could introduce yourself,
Mohamed Al-Hussaini from the Arab League. Thank you very much, really, for a very informative session. I would like just to add to Mr. Peter, I mean, maybe he doesn't have the time to say it, that they have also an envoy, special envoy to the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. They have also an envoy, special envoy for minority, Muslim minority throughout the world. Rarely any Muslim country has that. And many people question that for good or bad, we don't know. But really, I remember the envoy for minority visited 80 countries with Muslim minorities. I moved to Turkey since I was a diplomat in Turkey. Of course, it's surprising for me, the result. I thought that they will stay longer in power, really, the AKP, the government that's considered with Islamic roots. And they have done America really with the economy. And I was to my surprise. And to my surprise that the Kurds also, they got 80 seats. And Turkish people as nationalistic, I thought that the Turks would get less. And even if you speak Turkish in the parliament, for member of parliament who are Kurds, they are banned and maybe they will be expelled up to that extent. So I am surprised, really, with the result. I don't know. Is it a new spring in Turkey? I don't know. This is also, again, we reconnect. Okay, I will know. I have so many. Really, you have five speakers. But anyway, I will stop here. I have so many.
If you have more questions.
Okay, I will stop there. I will.
Okay. I go each way. The lady here. Try to be fair on each side.
Yeah. Oh. Hi, my name is Reverend Susan Taylor, and I'm with the National Office of the Church of Scientology here in Washington. And Peter, just really quickly to you, I was wondering, having been part of the U.S. State Department's working group on religion and foreign policy when it started a few years ago, I was wondering if we're not doing a disservice to all of our work by continuing to call the Islamic State Islamic State. That because one of the things that came out of the working group was the importance of nomenclature. If you've read the reports that came out of our working group, correctly naming things. And again, for instance, like if a Catholic person were to start some kind of a group that was, you know, a hate group and this sort of thing, we wouldn't call it a Catholic blah, 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 blah. And even if the person himself decided to use the word Catholic or whatever. But so in this case, are we doing ourselves a disservice, especially in light of what you said, too?
Who is the we you're referring to?
We all of us. Are concerned about this, the situation of mixing religion and, hate groups and terrorism groups. It's a terrorist group, period. And if you name it a certain thing, then because, like, especially here in the United States, and because then it spreads fear amongst those of us that are not of the Muslim faith, you know, you look at somebody else and say, he's Muslim, so maybe he's part of this Islamic State thing, whatever. Do you understand?
Sure.
Yeah.
I take one more in the back.
Thank you for an excellent program. Gary Mehring, I write on topic of faith and public policy. I'm somewhat of a student of Karen Armstrong and her writings in the 90s, the History of God, and looking at all three monotheistic religions, she identified the key problem of fundamentalism in all three monotheistic religions throughout history. And so in some ways, we shouldn't be surprised and at times turns to violence. So we're focusing on Islam particularly right now. She goes on in her latest book to talk about, try to separate the the terrorism and so-called religious violence from what's often nationalism and power grabs throughout history, all the religious wars from Crusades to the 30 Years' War in Germany, blah, blah, blah. A lot of it was nationalism and power under the guise of religion. Anyway, I would particularly ask Evelyn. I am a German extraction student of Bonhoeffer and Martin Luther, and the difficult history in Germany of the 30 Years' War, the Holocaust, the complicity of the Catholic Church and the Lutheran Church, of which I am a member, in the Holocaust. How does Germany wrestle with that in light of current events, and do you write about that?
Okay, so I'm going to ask Susanna to respond to the question that we addressed to them, and I start here to rebalance, unless you want a few minutes to collect yourself.
No, it was just such a big question how we deal with all. I think over the decades we made a big progress in Germany from having a big problem with our own with the crimes we committed during World War II, and with denying the Holocaust to a stage where we are now, where I think it's impossible to say didn't happen, and we don't have to learn from it. So, but when we look at the debate about terrorism today, I would say that we didn't learn enough from our two dictatorships yet, and I think we learned, the churches learned a lot from their from the mistakes in their history. So if you would have like we did for this week, an interview with the former head of our Protestant church in Germany, Wolfgang Huber, one of our most wonderful professor for ethics, on the relation between religion and politics and religion and democracy. When he speaks about the challenges for some of our Muslim communities in Germany, he would immediately go to these topics you mentioned and say what we should have learned from the 30 Years' War. But at the same time, he would be very precise in analyzing what is a theology of violence today, and what are the duties of religious groups in democracy, and in which respect they should approach freedom and collect under the roof of freedom, right? And what are the challenges in politics to come to a conclusion there. So to say it very practically, we know very well at the moment where hate is preached in Germany, and we know, I mean, we have some churches that are a problem, but this is a very minor problem at the moment, but we know the mosques where militant Islamism is preached, and we have a problem to deal with it, because we don't want to fall back into laws that we had during the dictatorship, at least during the second dictatorship, especially, yeah. I don't know the English word for it, but it's Gesinnungsgesetze. Anyway, so I think we learned from our history, but we use it as an excuse also. We have a cheap pacifism at the moment, in my opinion, where we say, oh, we cannot do anything, we cannot involve anywhere because we did wrong in the past. But I think we are doing wrong also when we, for example, turn away from what's happening in Central African Republic between Christians and Muslims. But that's my opinion.
No, we cannot. We cannot.
Okay.
After the
sorry.
Yes, just a very brief comment to Peter. Yes, I agree. Thank you for your comments. I agree that there is a disconnect between this ecclesiastical time and the Westphalian cosmology. But I guess this is the task of your office, to look at both. Because, for example, with the announcement of the synod, which is a very political, very religious, yes, at the, but the, when it was, when it took place, it also very political. Yes. So you have to look at both. So the political messages are coming sometimes from the religious field as well.
No, well, I think the ambassador left, and it was more of a comment than a question. So if there's any other questions on Turkey, maybe I can build that into.
Peter, you want to respond briefly?
Well, yeah. I mean, first of all, again, to our colleague from the Arab League who's departed, just a clarification. He indicated that our office has a special representative for Muslim minorities. That's not strictly the case. We have a special representative for Muslim communities, minority or majority. But there are tensions around such a framing, right? Because you're suddenly elevating a religious component of identity when you have someone who's supposedly engaged with through a religious identity, right? If we're, you know, a car mechanic in Senegal has multiple identities, and if you engage with that person through the, you know, Muslim identity channel, you know, what are you saying in doing that, and what impact does that have? With respect to the question of naming and how we refer to this thing out there these days. I mean, obviously, as many of you will know, it's been the official position of the U.S. government not to call it the Islamic State, but to refer to it through the acronym associated with the broader social movement that it was prior to declaring itself to be a more settled form of polity. So, you know, officially we've referred to it as ISIL. In the building itself, people will say both ISIL and ISIS. Secretary Kerry has been a fan of, you know, throwing around the term Daesh lately. And so, you know, the U.S. government has a position on this. And yet, at the same time, and so you're right that naming has effects and has functions, but at the same time, I don't think we want to overly emphasize that dimension, and that, you know, I don't think it's what the U.S. government and what other Western governments refer to this thing as that's likely to be the driving force behind how people perceive it and their willingness to support it or embrace it. I think that's driven by all kinds of other things. I mean, you know, during the course of the Cold War, there were all sorts of entities around the world that styled themselves as people's democratic republics of this or that. And, you know, very few of them, as far as I can tell, belonged to the people, were democratic in nature, or, you know, looked anything like a republic according to a conventional definition of that. And yet, you know, that's how they were referred to, simply in a functional way. So, I mean, I think you're absolutely right that naming has an impact and naming has an effect. And, you know, I think it's an appreciation of that point that has led the U.S. government to take the position that it has on how it officially refers to this entity. And yet, at the same time, let's not fool ourselves in thinking that that's really a major component of how this all plays out.
Okay, I take here to do.
This is a question for Lucian. Question for Lucian. And the question is, where do the Oriental churches fit in your scheme? Most of them don't have a structure or a leadership style that can be engaged in the Western debate, and yet they're very much affected, with the exception of the Copts, who do have something of a structure that engages Western politics. How do you handle that? And I guess a second quick question, what do you make of the announcement that Metropolitan John Zazoulas will present the Pope's encyclical along with Cardinal Turkson on a week from today?
I take two more. Yes.
This is Amjad Chaudhry. I'm the Muslim community, and I'm thankful to Peter that you have international religious freedom, and that department is working very well. And it's gone to Canada and to Europe also. And at the same time, I think there was something about the Muhammad, peace be upon him, that he retaliated in some instances, like his uncle's liver was chewed or something. But I think the everything he did was for the peace of the society and for peace. And that's what MDA Muslim community is all over the world is saying to the whole world, that everything done was peace. I think not only the Islam, but other religion also. If you go back to their religion, they are all about peace. And at the same time, I ask Peter, that is your department is politically saying, thinking about the ISIS or something. That's my question.
One more and then we close here. Yes.
Thank you very much. I'm Julie Chamberlain from George Washington University, a PhD candidate there. And I was wondering, Peter, what kinds of, like, what training for religion looks like to colleagues? What is it? You named the problem of naming and labeling.
Yes.
What does that look like on an everyday basis? Do you have seminars? Do you have PowerPoints? How do you actually talk about, you know, this? Okay. What does it look like in the everyday world? And then I didn't know if other people had kind of, you know, suggestions for what that might look like, or if there's agreement on kind of how you what tools you use, how you kind of produce knowledge about religion and transmit it. So thank you.
Thank you. Solution.
Yes, thank you very much for the questions. I mean, the title of my report is Eastern Christianity, and I spoke a lot about Orthodox Christianity. But I mean, this was one of the issues. I mean, it didn't have enough time. One of the major issues in the discussions with policymakers. I mean, the perception is, for example, in the Middle East, aren't they all Catholics, or aren't they all Baptist? And what I tried to do in the report is to show the diversity of Eastern Christianity. So it's not only Orthodox, also the Oriental, also so many small churches that you have to take into account. So the Greek Catholics will fit there. I mean, you have to look on a national case. For example, if you look in Ukraine, you see they're very strongly advocates of the pro-European stance versus the predominant pro-Kremlin or pro-Orthodox Eastern associated view. So you have to look, I said, on the national cases, also the how they emerge from the Cold War period, many churches been reestablished. You have tensions on property restitutions throughout the region. So it's a more complex situation, but you have to, I mean, yeah, definitely the Greek Catholics, my opinion, have to be associated with the Orthodox churches to be part of the wider discussion. On your second point, on the most recent developments, I'm not wrong, Evelyn just wrote a piece for the Transatlantic Academy. It's on the website, just published a few hours ago. It's the Ecumenical Patriarch has been considered as the Green Patriarch. So in all the meetings between him and Pope Francis, we have many discussions on climate change, how what we can do, bring the churches together, closer relationship between the two. So the latest developments have to be perceived within that phenomenon.
And then I will also like...
Okay. I just want to make sure that I understand, sir, your question exactly. The air conditioning is loud in my ear. Okay, now I understand. Thank you very much. So that gives me an opportunity to clarify. It's not our position that ISIS is itself primarily political, right? There's this debate about, you know, is it really a religious entity, or is it simply the former Iraqi Ba'athist security apparatus using religion as a packaging? We're not taking a position on this. The answer to this, I think, is somewhere in the middle, right? It's undeniable that aspects of both of these things are present. Our point about politics is that the answers to dealing with the conditions that have made it possible for ISIS to appear and grow are ultimately political questions in both Syria and Iraq. And so regardless of whether you see ISIS as religious or political, the longer term answers for dealing with it, you know, exist within the realm of politics. With respect to the question of training, thanks for raising that. It's something we're heavily involved in, actually. The Foreign Services Institute, FSI, which is the main training facility for American diplomats located out in Arlington, has actually been running a week-long course on religion and foreign policy for several years. Early versions of this course, I think it's fair to say, were more like a support group, almost therapy, for that kind of fairly small cabal of folks in the State Department who were committed to the religious engagement mission, and they, you know, got together in this course and kind of, you know, affirmed each other's belief that this was an important thing to be thinking about and doing. And in that sense, it was kind of, and sorry to mix in so many religious metaphors, it was kind of preaching to the converted. Since our office opened, we've tried to really develop the components of an actual curriculum for religion and religious engagement training that in our minds have sort of three key components. One is that piece of it that is making sure that our diplomats understand sort of the ABCs of world religion, you know, world religious demography, major groups and the geographies globally of those groups and their basic backgrounds and histories. Second is the question of how to think about religion in relation to U.S. foreign policy. How do you understand the interface between specific things that the U.S. is trying to do in the world and where religion fits into that? And third is the question of, you know, fine that you now have that understanding. How do you go about designing a religious engagement strategy to actually advance the priorities of a U.S. embassy in some particular country? So this course is offered a couple times a year, and with each iteration of it now, we're kind of refining it piece by piece. The goal, because right now it's a voluntary course, right? And we've succeeded in sort of mixing up the demographics so that it's now taken by people who are often going out to posts where religion is a particularly important component of the societies that they'll be working in. But our longer-term goal is to embed a module on religion within what's called the A100 course, which is the boot camp that Jocelyn referred to. It's the core training that all outgoing U.S. Foreign Service officers receive. As you can imagine, you've got a very finite space within that curriculum. And there's always, anytime you want to add something new to it, there's considerations about, well, what are we taking out in order to make space for that? The British, interestingly enough, the British government, the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, has added a religion module into their version of the same thing. So there's a lot of, you know, engagement and learning between different foreign ministries in Europe and the U.S. and Canada in particular that are trying to figure out how to work this in. That said, that boot camp A100 level is just one piece of it, because being able to do religious engagement well is also a function of getting buy-in from folks higher up the chain, right? If you have, you know, and people tend to get more risk-averse the higher up the chain they get. So it's also about, you know, convincing the bureaucratic equivalent of middle managers and senior policymakers that you know, getting more comfortable with this is not going to be dangerous to them and can actually help them succeed better. But it is something we're paying a lot of attention to.
Okay, I'm going to turn to the two ladies to ask them on one foot, each of you, to say closing remarks. Nora.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I guess I'll just come back to this question of, you know, what happened and related to something Lucien raised about, and Evan also talked about indirectly, the sort of the fate of non-Muslim and Muslim minority communities in the Middle East and in Turkey. There's these communities are very small, but I think the composition of the new parliament, if and when it's formed, which will be after, it'll be in a couple of days, due to some technicalities, but it will have four Christians, so two Armenians, one Greek Orthodox, and one Syriac. It will have, I have to check the time. I mean, I know that there were 65 Alevi candidates on the list, some Alevi Kurds coming from the Kurdish party, and then Turkish Alevis from the CHP, the pro-secular secularist party. There's a Roma parliamentarian, as I already mentioned, that there's this very high representation of women for in a country where that has been a major challenge over the years to have women's representation in parliament. So, I mean, in that sense, I think the elections were a signal that as much as one group can deliver the goods in a functioning democracy, and the AKP most certainly did deliver the goods for a long time in a very transformative way, it is a credit to and a testimony to where they brought Turkey, that the Turkish electorate can then turn around and get over its, you know, some of the more kind of sectarian reflexes that it has to put a parliament like this into, to elect a parliament of this composition. So no matter what happens, I mean, there's a lot of debate right now about what sort of a coalition is going to be formed and implications of this for immediate economic stability and so forth. But at the end of the day, it's really, I think, a credit to all of the parties in Turkey and really a testimony to the health of Turkish democracy.
You want to say a few words?
Maybe I can go to one question this that was not answered, I guess. I think you didn't speak about Bartholomew, right? Because you asked about this recent, you mentioned it shortly. But I think this was so interesting for us as a newspaper too, and we are waiting curiously for the encyclical to come out next week. And maybe you don't know that the Pope wanted to sign the encyclical together with Bartholomew, which would have been outstanding and never happened before, and a big topic for you experts, academics in the field, to analyze what it means. The Secretariat of State didn't want it so far. So the fact that he did this now has to do with this not signing, but obviously the Green Patriarch was in the game. And this is interesting for us as a newspaper from a political perspective when we follow Pope Francis's devout and political mission to involve his church in the matters of the world in a peaceful way, that we see him trying to create a common ground to be literally able to work together with as many players as possible. So he even spoke with Putin. People might criticize this, but I think this belongs to his strategy to create a field that is different, that is political, but different from the normal politics. So as a political leader, he wants to make as a religious leader, he wants to make a progress in the political field, right? And I hope we will follow these very different things going on in the world in a serious way, so to not be stuck in ideological and PC discussions that we sometimes have in our society, but try to analyze what's going on. And I think, in my opinion, it belongs to the work also to sometimes to make a step forward where it is not possible in other fields. So, for example, when we have the discussion about Islam and Islamism, and we see that the liberal Muslims have no platform, like in Germany, for example, and they are no partners for the political class because the official groups are very, very conservative. So we can give them a platform, for example, and there we also become part of the game, and we have to be careful how we behave. Yeah.
Thank you. I think we have passed the time So I would like to thank you for being here and interacting still after 2:10. And I would like to thank all the panelists for their contribution. Thank you. Oh, and there are copies of the report in the back. Yeah.